Hi, and welcome to CPH Session 18, Descriptive Statistics, Summarizing and Visualizing Data. This is Part E, Analysis of Likert Items. Have you ever taken a survey with a question like this? No doubt you probably have. A question item like this one asks your level of agreement or level of satisfaction relative to a statement like the one here. Here, the question makes some statement about your satisfaction with yourself, perhaps from a psychological evaluation. So my question is, what is this type of question called? If you said a Likert scale, you're like most people, but you're wrong. His name was Likert. However, that's not it. I have a bad habit of still calling them Likert questions. However, I'll try to at least be consistent in referring to the man as Mr. Likert. More importantly, though, this question is not a scale. It should be correctly called a Likert or Likert item. In Session 18, Part E, we'll define what a Likert item is and how it's different from a Likert scale. Then, we'll talk about how to analyze and summarize data collected using Likert items and Likert scales. So many times in social sciences, we want to measure character and personality traits. Measuring attitudes, character, and personality traits can be difficult, though. If we want to transfer these qualities into quantitative measures for data analysis, qualitative research techniques have become more popular in recent years, and that has relieved some of this dilemma. However, many social scientists still rely on quantitative measures of attitude, character, and personality traits. In 1932, Rinus Likert, an American psychologist, developed a procedure for measuring attitudinal scales. His original question format from Likert used a series of questions with five response alternatives: strongly, disapprove, disapprove, undecided, approve, and strongly approve. So if we assign numerical codes 1 through 5, as it's shown here, well, we could more easily do quantitative analysis of our attitudinal or almost qualitative type results. And thus, the Likert item was born. But what makes a question a Likert item? Let's look at a Likert question and elucidate its characteristics. The first thing we see is that the responses are arranged horizontally. Next, each possible choice has an integer assigned to it, like shown here, 1, 2, 3, 4. And those integers increase consecutively with each choice. Thirdly, the verbal labels are considered by most to have meanings that are evenly spaced. So in our example, the steps in meaning from strongly disapprove to somewhat disapprove is about the same as the difference between somewhat approve to neutral, and so on. On the other hand, if our four choices here were something like it's okay, it's all right, not bad, and then good and awesome, I think we can agree that the first three choices are basically the same and they aren't evenly graded. Of course, defining whether the terms are evenly spaced is a gray area, and ultimately it's left up to the researcher's discretion, as long as no standard already exists. And so another thing to note is that every choice has a verbal label. Fourthly, the verbal labels start and end with opposites. Strongly approve can be considered the opposite of strongly disapprove. And it's centered around a neutral middle. So because of this stipulation, Likert items usually have an odd number of choices, most commonly 5, but 7, 9, and even 11 choices are possible. The only case where we would have an even number is where we omit the neutral response, and that approach is sometimes used in research. And finally, the fifth characteristic of a Likert item we see here is that the question measures the respondent's level of agreement or disagreement to a target statement. However, while this last characteristic is true of what Likert developed, today we normally consider questions a Likert item if it meets the first four characteristics. So for example, if the choices were about satisfaction, something like strongly dissatisfied to strongly satisfied, we could still treat it as a Likert item. So let's look at some examples and decide whether or not they are Likert items. So, is this question a Likert item? The question says, select your level of agreement with the statement, I eat healthy foods on a regular basis. So for now, we'll disregard some of the ambiguity in the definition of healthy foods and regular basis and just focus only on what type of question it is. Well, if we look at it, we see that the choices are arranged horizontally. The integers are consecutive. They go 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. The words are evenly spaced in their meaning, in the standard strongly disagree to strongly agree. And we see that the ends are opposites and they're centered around a neutral. So, yes, we've met all of these stipulations, these criteria for a Likert item, so we can consider it a Likert item. How about this one? How often do you go out to see a movie? Okay. Well, it's arranged horizontally. The integers are consecutive. I'd say the words are pretty evenly spaced in their meaning. And average is probably a middle of the road neutral response. But are the ends opposites? Is very often the opposite of never? Not really. So, we're still not fully meeting that fourth criterion. So no, this one is not a Likert item. However, as long as we have criteria 1 through 3, we can still call this a Likert type item. And for analysis purposes, we can treat it the same as a Likert item. However, just be careful to correctly refer to a question like this as a Likert type item. What about this one? It says, how often do you smoke cigarettes? Okay, well, the first thing we can see that it's not arranged horizontally, but we can always reformat that. The numbers are consecutive, so we're good on that one. What about the meanings of the words? Personally, I would say that the difference between never and once in a while is pretty small, while the difference between once in a while and 1 to 5 a day is bigger. So the word meanings might not be evenly spaced. And then we can also see that never is not the opposite of more than 5 per day, and it certainly doesn't have a neutral middle. So this question is not a Likert item, and it's also not a Likert type item. This would just be a multiple choice question that generates categorical ordinal data. And so we would look back to the lessons on binary data to decide how to analyze it. All right, one last example. What about this one? We see this sometimes on online questionnaires. Here we can choose these options from 1 to 7. Well, first, it is horizontal. That's true. It has consecutive integers, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. So far, so good. But one big problem is that each choice does not have a word associated with it. So even though the ends are opposites, helpful and not helpful, and presumably the middle four would be our neutral choice, we categorically cannot consider this a Likert or Likert type item, because the differentiation between 2 and 3, for example, is unclear and open to interpretation. This type of question can generally be categorized into a group called differential scales, which we talked about in our question format portion of the course. And more specifically, this type of question is called a discrete visual analog scale question. And most likely we should consider its data type to be categorical ordinal. So far we've talked about Likert or Likert type items. Likert items are individual questions like this one. So what then is a Likert scale? Well, a Likert scale is a summation of four or more Likert items that ask about the same subject, such as attitudes and self-esteem, in this example. This summation is a numerical indication of the respondent's overall positive or negative orientation towards that subject. And that's how we get the basis for a Likert scale. So for example, a questionnaire might have a total of 120 Likert items, and those 120 items are divided into 12 Likert scales, each with 10 items in it. And it's really important that we carefully differentiate between Likert items and Likert scales, as we'll talk about soon. And it's important to note that Likert himself did not analyze individual questions. We can see an example of a Likert scale in the WHO's Quality of Life survey. It has different versions, and one of the versions is called the brief version, which has 26 Likert items that evaluate four domains of quality of life. So in other words, it has 26 Likert items divided into four Likert scales. That brief version was derived from a full version, which has a total of 100 questions. And shown here are five of the questions from the brief version of the questionnaire. We can see that these questions are Likert or Likert type items. So if you administered this questionnaire and you were the data analyst, these would be your instructions taken directly from the manual for the Quality of Life survey. So the first thing you do is you would enter the numerical values for each response into the database. If you see strongly disagree, you would enter 1, and if you see strongly agree, you would enter 5, for example. The next thing we do is we have to reverse score 3 of the questions. Questions 3, 4, and 26 are negatively worded, and that's good practice in Likert item questionnaires to have some reverse worded questions in there. And so we have to reverse the numbering for these. So for example, 1 would be changed to a 5 in our database only for these 3 specific questions. Then we break the questions into 4 groups representing 4 domains of quality of life. For example, the questions here in the first domain are about the first domain, which is physical health. These 4 scores are Likert scales. And so now we would have a numerical indication of a respondent's overall quality of life related to physical health within that first Likert scale. Well, now that we've differentiated between Likert items and Likert scales, the question is, how do we summarize and analyze them? How do we compute descriptive statistics, and what kind of inferential analyses can we do? Well, consider our options. It depends on what kind of data type we consider the data to be. So I've listed the 4 possible data types: nominal categorical, ordinal categorical, continuous interval, and continuous ratio. Well, first, we can safely say it's not nominal. By definition, a Likert item has an inherent order, and nominal does not have order. Furthermore, we can rule out continuous ratio. To be a ratio, 0 has to mean 0, and we'd probably not use a 0 to code a Likert item, and it would be hard to imagine a situation where that 0 coded would mean 0 of something, which is a requirement for a ratio. But it is easy to argue that you could treat it as either ordinal, categorical, or continuous interval. This decision matters because it determines whether we're computing proportions or means and standard deviations, or if we're visualizing it using pie charts or histograms. It's even more important when when we want to do inferential statistics, which we'll cover in session 19. Well, what I can tell you is that there is still some debate, but generally the consensus among statisticians is that individual Likert items should be treated as categorical ordinal variables, while Likert scales should be treated as continuous intervals. And this table nicely summarizes which data analysis procedures we should use among Likert and Likert type items and Likert scales. It invokes some terms for inferential statistics, which we will be covering in the next session. And that's it for session 18. In session 19, we'll cover inferential statistics, which tries to draw conclusions beyond the objective statements about our observations.